I am proud to introduce the next governor of the state of New York, Marc Molinaro.
Thank you. Thank you. Mom, I made it. Thank you, Governor Pataki, and I think you might just be right. Who might argue? Many years ago, a man far better than I, who also stood before this convention, spoke 13 words that we as a party have sadly forgotten. Nobody cares how much you know, Teddy Roosevelt said, until they know how much you care. Hold on to that thought for just a minute. I'd like to get back to it, but I have some business to do, and that is first to say to all of you, from the bottom of my heart, thank you. Thank you for the welcome, thank you for the support, thank you for your friendship, and thank you for what we will get done in November of 2018. On behalf of my family, I thank you, and I think you may have already met my son, Jack. You have Jack to blame for my candidacy. I'll get to that in a minute, but I want to thank you on behalf of my wife, Corinne, who makes everything right in our lives. Thank you on behalf of my children, Abigail and Jack and Eli, and a yet-to-be-named fourth Molinaro on his or her way this November. The governor suggested that Elmer was a really good name. I want you to know that Jack, my son Jack, who you met, he's a bit of a character. He's a good character. When all of you asked me to consider running for governor, I said, Jack, they're calling and asking your dad to run for governor again. And he said, well, how many times do they have to ask you? Jack offered a very important piece of advice. He said to me just recently, he said, he would prefer if I stood before a crowd and said, hi, my name is Marc Molinaro. I'm running for governor. Please vote for me. And then sit down. He did. Against his advice, I stand before you today grateful, humbled, especially humbled for the leap of faith that you're taking in me. And it is with that humility that I accept your nomination for governor of the great state of New York. So Chairman Cox, Governor Pataki, distinguished chairwomen and chairmen, members of the New York State Republican Committee, many of you barely knew me a year ago, but I have sensed all along that you know exactly who I am. As a man, son, husband, and father. And I think that's why you've selected me as your candidate, and if I'm right, and I think I am, I am overwhelmingly honored. I think it's also a testament to this party because in truth, I'm no one special. If I weren't in office, I'd be someone you brush past on the street, or whose cart you might bump into at Sam's Club, you know, the one with all the baby wipes and diapers in it. I don't come from wealth or fame, and I wasn't born into a political dynasty. I'm no television star. I'm just an everyday New Yorker with a calling and some hard-earned know-how, and I make no other claim. And so I stand before you today proudly, staking my claim to normalcy, to being an ordinary New Yorker, and I wear it. I wear it as a badge of honor and aspire to be nothing more. Being an everyday citizen informs me. It provides me insight and empathy and humility as I make my decisions. Humility is something I learned as a boy. It's hard not to feel that way when the cereal you're shoveling into your mouth before school is paid for with food stamps. When you listen to your single mom in her early 30s whispering into the phone with the electric company in hopes you won't hear her asking for the lights to be kept on until the money from babysitting comes in from another working mom struggling with her bills. Thank you, Mom. You learn humility when God hands your family gifts others may consider challenges. You're thankful for your blessings and march forward gratefully, faithfully. The family I come from is like so many others in New York, ethnic, working class, unremarkable. First in Yonkers, on Willow Street, with my grandparents downstairs and aunts and uncles up the street, you know, the whole Italian thing. Parties in the garage, gravy on the oven, loud men and women. My mom resembles that remark. And later in Dutchess County, or as they called it then, the country. Some still do. Life growing up was real. There was divorce and abandonment. There were patches on the husky Wrangler jeans. But there was mostly faith and love. And it prevailed. We believed in ourselves and in one another. We believed in our neighbors. And most importantly, we believed in tomorrow. And we still do. So I tell you my background not for effect, but for a far more important reason to me and hopefully you. I share my childhood because I refuse to cede compassion to the Democratic or Working Families Party or to anyone who falsely claims its mantle. I refuse to concede compassion as Marc Molinaro, the man. And I refuse to concede compassion as Marc Molinaro, the Republican candidate for governor of the state of New York. Not one inch, not one millimeter, not for a second, not ever. I look out to each of you. I look out from this podium into the eyes of New York Republicans, but also into those of Democrats and independents who may be watching at home or online, to liberals, conservatives, and moderates, gay, straight, black, white, Asian, Latino, young, old, married, and unmarried, to those able to pay their bills, and those, like my family, struggling too hard. I speak to you from the depths of my soul in saying this. I care. I know what it means to struggle. I know what it's like to need a helping hand. And I care about making your life a little better, a little fuller, and a lot easier. You know, Teddy Roosevelt was right, and we don't say it enough, especially in the climate in which we live. Nobody cares how much you know until they know how much you care. Indeed. Watching special interests spend millions of dollars on television ads in New York year after year, money other people earned to attack elected leaders for not spending or taxing enough never ceases to amaze me. I wonder if they realize what $5 or $10 extra dollars a week can mean to a single mom or father trying to make rent or fix the truck. They claim to be compassionate, but they have no idea how hard it is to live in the most overtaxed state in America. If taxing and spending were the best way to lift families out of poverty, we'd have the best government in the country, and I wouldn't be running for governor. Overtaxing and overspending, it's a dream killer, a job depriver. It robs working people from the ability to save. Now listen, I know there must be a strong safety net. God knows I understand that as well as anyone. But ladies and gentlemen, Albany will not be a cash cow for the rich and powerful any longer. We will not be an ATM for out-of-touch politicians anymore, and not for the big money donors, not for the politicians looking to dole out billions of dollars in political favors, not when I'm governor. The pay-for-play schemes, this New York fire sale ends, and it ends now. Government will have priorities. Government will have priorities again. People in need and things we use, like subways and bridges, streets and sidewalks, clean drinking water and treatment plants to stop pollutants, not political donors and corporate lobbyists looking for a taxpayer handout. Those are not priorities. Not to me, not for you, not for New York, not anymore. Government will live within its means when I'm governor, because government living within its means is compassionate to those trying to live within their own. Working and middle-class families can't afford to pay for the political ambitions of individuals any longer. Our priority will be the people, not a governor seated atop the heap, plotting to run for president, trading billions in your dollars in contracts for millions in campaign contributions. A former New York governor addressed this point exactly. He said to those looking to run for office, "Decide exactly what you want to achieve," he said some years ago. "Do you want to help people, or do you want to be powerful?" What Mario Cuomo was saying was that one should seek public office to do good, not feed one's ego or career needs. Bullies and megalomaniacs need not apply. Think about that for a moment. I know how government is supposed to work, and I know how to make it more effective and more efficient. Governing is a passion I was given for some reason I may never know. I too found what my purpose was, Luater. I use it proudly and apologetically. I can't invent a new light bulb. I don't know how to rebuild a transmission, though my dad, who's here, tried many times to teach me. And I'm unable to run a 4-minute mile, though I try. But I can govern and manage a government well. And I know how to make government serve the people. As you know, and sadly you saw in that video, I began my career as a very young person. I don't know what I was thinking wearing shorts and a button-down shirt. I really don't. I was told it was in 1995. It wasn't. But in 1995, I was elected mayor of Tivoli, population 1,300. There are likely more people in this room. No, close. It made me the youngest mayor in America. Outgoing mayor Ed Nice asked me to run. So, of course, as a 19-year-old, I ran home and asked my mom if it'd be okay I run for mayor. She said yes, right after you clean your room. I wasn't, despite my high opinion of myself, I wasn't elected because of my good looks or party affiliation. In fact, we ran without party labels. I was elected because I was Mark, the kid at the deli people generally liked, and most trusted. My neighbors knew I was in it for the right reasons. They knew I actually cared about Tivoli and the people that live there. They knew I'd be a straight shooter, that I'd say it the way I see it, regardless of political affiliation. And from day one, I've had a clear and simple governing philosophy. Do what works. Fix what's broken. When you make a mistake, admit it. Make it right. And that's it. I'm not in office to pontificate, nor do I have any interest. I have no interest in shoving my opinions down other people's throats. My job as governor will be delivering affordable and accountable government, not preaching a sermon or issuing edicts for television coverage. I have no interest in ideology for ideology's sake. That doesn't solve problems. People do. It's results that I'll be after. And I think it's why people of all backgrounds and viewpoints keep electing me. First as a mayor, then as county legislator, then state assemblyman, and I am going to find my colleagues in the state assembly and have a very serious conversation with them. And now for the last 6 years as county executive. It's proved to me that good government is indeed the best politics. People know when you have an interest in them and when you have their interests in mind. They can tell. They know when you're getting the job done. In determining whether or not to run for governor, I had to decide whether I could be all in, not only as a candidate, I enjoy that, but also as governor. I might enjoy that too. My passion is not, despite the fact that I do often say the most dangerous place in Dutchess County is between me and a microphone, my passion is not giving speeches. It's working for the people and governing well to do my best. And so I had to ask, would I have what it takes to actually do what needs to be done to transform New York, to set it free from the powerful, the privileged, and return it to the people? Could we together do what's necessary to harness New York's true human and economic potential? For job providers, families, young and old, not only in the five boroughs of New York, but on the island and in the Hudson Valley, in central New York, the North Country, western New York, the southern tier, in every corner of the state. And the answer for me is yes, emphatically yes, 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 we have to. We have to for our children and our neighbors' children. For grandparents watching grandkids grow up on a computer screen, for immigrants working 3 part-time jobs to keep the lights on, so kids can see a future in learning and hard work, so those living with addiction and mental illness know the value of their own lives, for parents stuck in the cycle of poverty whose knees ache from praying, for people in homes that needed a new coat of paint 5 years ago, for New Yorkers ready to leave for Florida, Texas, or the Carolinas, and some to Virginia, people working 60-hour work weeks in the city paying 60% of their income on rent, 10th-generation New Yorkers who did everything right and still can't make ends meet. For the family farmer who's overburdened, overregulated, and undervalued. Ladies and gentlemen, these are our friends. They are you and I, ultimately. When are we going to break the chains of self-interested government? When are we going to free ourselves from the humiliating corruption in Albany that not only taxes our wallet, but our spirit? When will we have had enough? It has to be now, it has to be now, and it has to be now. We're being hollowed out. We are being hollowed out from the inside day after day by a government we stopped trusting and believing in more than a decade ago. It has to be now that we put our foot down. Today, Wednesday, May 23rd, 2018, all of us, Republicans, Democrats, and independents alike, we need to work together to shake the yoke of corruption from our backs, throw off the never-ending burden of a government that spends more than it should, taxes more than we can afford, and mortgages our children's future. Now, in the coming weeks, we are going to lay out a bold property tax cut for New Yorkers that the defenders of the status quo will despise. They'll hate it.
but they will quiver. Because we're going to finally cut loose the anchor holding down Upstate and throw off the burdens on the backs of families and homeowners struggling too hard. Stay tuned, I promise you, because we're going to break some eggs. No more sacred cows in New York. No third rail excuses. Only real, meaningful, sustained tax relief and economic opportunity for everyone who calls this great state home. Together we are going to fundamentally alter this state's tax structure all across for New York, for New York. And we're going to do it out of compassion for the everyday people of this state, for the people I grew up with, for parents trapped in our cities, for those voiceless and disabled, for those seeking to grow jobs and find a job, those up against the ropes. And I'll tell you this, the stakeholders in the Albany power and money game will spit out their coffee as we roll out our vision. They'll gnash their teeth and swear it can't be done. They'll start writing the TV ads. And yes, even the governor will start leveling the tax. And I'll say this, watch me. Watch me and hold me to it. Watch me and hold me to it. Under our plan and with our vision together, New Yorkers will keep significantly more money in their paychecks when I'm governor. Money they now hand over to a bloated, burdensome, arrogant, intrusive state government. And who do you think? Who do you think will spend that money better? The family next door or some bureaucracy in Albany that hasn't been audited in 80 years? Under our plan and with our vision, sales tax revenue will grow as families have money to finally repaint that home, as new homes are built and businesses move in. All those upstate college students, they'll be able to stay in New York and put down roots. It's been a long time since that's happened. Today, they get an education and flee south and west, and with them, their innovation, their talent, and their potential. We're going to find massive savings, and they're there. I mean, my gosh, $3.5 billion per mile for East Side access. That's seven times the average elsewhere in the world. You better believe we'll find it. You have my word. We will lead real local-centered shared services as I've done in Dutchess and respect local leaders who toil every day to make their communities better. We will modernize an outdated state government to achieve efficiencies, and we will eliminate waste, fraud, and abuse that is stealing from our taxpayers day in and day out. Now listen, it won't be easy, but I promise it will be easier than landing a career job in upstate New York these days, finding an affordable apartment in Brooklyn, no offense, or being a single working mom anywhere in New York. We will do this by working together. Together, we'll ignore the special interest doomsday ads and allow ourselves to think differently for a change. We'll care enough about one another to free ourselves from the corrupt morass in Albany. And so I say to you today, stay tuned. Stay tuned for the state-altering plans we'll be rolling out in the next weeks and months. They're going to bring about fundamental change in New York. They're going to put the Empire State back on its toes, bring explosive job growth to parts of the state that are dying. They're going to bring hope back to the little guy or little lady, to the working mom, to the big thinkers now headed to Texas or Tennessee. And ladies and gentlemen, as importantly, we're going to change the tone as well in politics and in business. We live in a toxic environment. We too often find every way to dismiss those with whom we disagree and belittle those who don't share our opinion. We must change the tone for New Yorkers and, by extension, change the tone for America. And I will take anyone to task who thinks otherwise. We have to change the way we treat one another in our everyday lives. And so I'm going to ask you to believe in yourselves, to believe in New York again. And believing in New York starts with believing the courageous women. Listen to this. Believing in New York starts with believing the courageous women who come forward in Albany or anywhere else to speak out against abusers. The days of sexual harassment, assaults, and hush money payouts must end. And we must start by believing. Start by believing those who have been abused. Start by believing those who are diminished or dismissed. And start by believing so together we can find truth for those who struggle in fear and in violence. That is compassionate. That is my party. And that is all of us. We will not concede that to anyone. And I am thrilled. I am absolutely thrilled to have as a running mate an outspoken, brilliant, and dynamic woman who's shown what it means to care about her state and neighbors, both as a mom of five and, although I'm catching up, Julie, I'm catching up, a mother of five and public official, the next Lieutenant Governor of the state of New York, Julie Killian. She gets knocked down, but she gets up again. And Julie has a degree in, get this, you know, we could use a few engineers and, you know, rocket scientists in Albany. Julie has a degree in chemical engineering from Notre Dame and an MBA in finance from NYU. She's worked tirelessly to help children with special needs in our classrooms. And she's been at the forefront of addressing drug addiction in her community. We share that same passion for these issues and a disdain for government that taxes too much and ignores the voices of those struggling too hard. We're going to reset. We are going to reset New York's priorities on January 1. Children and adults with disabilities, seniors without savings, classroom funding and special education, opioid addiction, safe drinking water, signal switches and subway tunnels, those are the kinds of things that'll move New York forward. Get that, listen clear. Those are the kinds of things that will get New York moving forward. And what's out? Cuomo's multi-billion dollar pay-for-play giveaways, gone yesterday. Corporate welfare, gone yesterday. We're going to make New York attractive to all businesses. Wasteful, duplicative, redundant, overlapping agencies, gone yesterday. Budget-busting Medicaid payments from counties that can't afford it, gone yesterday. New York will finally take responsibility and improve the way we help those in need while achieving savings. That alone saves $2 billion a year. Medicaid fraud, gone yesterday. Unless you want to lose your medical license and go to jail. Backdoor borrowing and garbage accounting that hides our true debt, gone yesterday. It's dishonest and it's dangerous and it's stealing from our children. Now, ladies and gentlemen, you might know this, but one of my very first jobs was mucking horse stalls in Tivoli as a kid. I can tell you that that might prepare me well for my journey to Albany. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to go to Albany and do a little mucking together, all of us. And to accomplish this, we're going to empower New Yorkers, advocates, and stakeholders. We're going to embrace every good idea and welcome anyone honestly and earnestly willing to bring about the change we need. We'll recruit the best and brightest from our colleges and businesses to audit this broken state government. And we will reform this state government and together revitalize New York. What we have now is an outmoded, outdated, and antiquated 20th century government at its worst. Together, we will move New York, pushing, screaming, into the 21st century. Start by zero-based budgeting from day one. No agency gets a dime until it can show we're getting what we pay for. If If an agency is just pushing around papers, it's a former agency. If a commission hasn't met and is merely occupying space, I'm shutting it down. And if it's an agency that's working well, a task force meeting its goals, or a program achieving its outcomes, we'll emulate it. We're going together to tap into the ingenuity of state workers and the genius of Silicon Valley and our upstate tech communities to streamline service delivery for those in need, making services less expensive and more effective. We're going to do it systematically in every department and every agency of state government. And I'm here today to announce, that yesterday is over, tomorrow is approaching, it's coming because it has to. We've reached our breaking point. We've got to get smart. We have to be compassionate, and we must put the New Yorkers paying the bills first. And to break the constant consumption of power and end a lack of accountability, I will demand a vote on term limits on day one. No one should assume and consume so much power, and every voice counts, whether you're in the majority or in seniority. Our government is in deep need of new energy and new ideas. We need to bring passion back to government and revitalize democracy in New York. And I commit to you today personally by pledging right now before each of you, before you and these TV cameras, that I will limit myself as governor to 2 terms, if you'll have me, 8 years, and that's it. I bet you on Long Island the governor's not making a similar pledge, although I welcome to try. Andrew Cuomo's already running for his 12th year on the job, while also running for president of the United States. Of course, unless he were to step down and run for president. So today I challenge Cynthia Nixon to join me in this self-imposed term limits pledge. I challenge her to go on television and do exactly the same. And you know what? I bet she will. She has decency. To combat corruption and end the pay-to-play schemes infecting our government, we'll immediately impanel a real Moreland Commission to follow the corruption, uncover the crimes, and bring offenders to justice on day one. Wherever it goes, no matter the path, no matter the offender, wherever it leads us, we will root out corruption and tear it out from its roots. Together, I'll ask the state legislature to adopt a universal code of ethics and establish a truly independent ethics commission to enforce it. And we'll empower an open government public information watchdog. We'll also do something that no one in government likes. We'll expand the freedom of information law to include all branches of government, all divisions, all agencies of state government. And together we'll end no-bid contracts and restore the state comptroller's independent procurement oversight. Together we'll fully implement a database of deals so the press and public know how your money's being spent and who's awarded the contracts. In the months ahead, as I campaign across this great state with Julie and with all of you, we'll lay out the details of our revolution to come, and it is a revolution for New York. A revolution in public education, in affordable health care, in disability services, showing New York what it means to think differently, in housing and in public transit, and in environmental protection too. Ladies and gentlemen, God gave us a beautiful but very temperamental planet. We must take care of it better. Preserving our natural resources, scenic vistas, and active farmland, improving our parks, and protecting drinking water for everyone in the state, and fully cleaning up our majestic Hudson River. Thank you, Governor Pataki, for focusing us on that resource. Together, we'll talk about re-empowering communities wherever possible, returning power from Albany to our towns, villages, cities, and school districts. This governor, This governor believes he alone can solve all our problems. He actually believes he is the government. I'm quoting him. He said he is the government. Governor Cuomo, you're wrong. The people of the state of New York are the government, and you're just a temporary worker who was entrusted to uphold the public trust and keep faith with the voters. He believes he's the government. I believe in you, in our shared capacity to solve any problem and overcome any challenge. And so I ask you today, are you ready for a revolution? Because I am. Are you ready to throw off the shackles of this state, off its economy, off its families? I am. Are you ready to kick corruption from the doors of Albany, down its hallways and into the streets? I am. Are you ready to make compassion, real, true, authentic compassion, the priority again? I am. And are you ready? Are you ready to break down barriers, accept, respect, and support every New Yorker, regardless of ability, to rebuild a state of inclusion and think differently? I am. And one more thing. Are you ready to spread the word of our revolt from Staten Island to St. Lawrence, from Erie to Rensselaer? Julie and I are. Are you? Do this. Do this with us together. Think differently. Act boldly. Are you ready to believe again in our state? Are you ready to believe in ourselves and each other? Are you ready to believe again in New York? Yesterday is over. Today is for action, so tomorrow will belong to all of us. All of us together. Believe again in this great state. Believe again in our capacity to solve problems. Believe again in each other. Thank you, and God bless you.
Just a small town girl, living in a lonely world. She took the midnight train going anywhere. Just a city boy, born and raised in South Detroit. He took the midnight train going. Share the night, it goes on.